introduce Professor Didier Sonnette. He is a professor and on the chair of entrepreneurial risks in the Department of Management, Technology and Economics at the Swiss Federal Institute of Technology in Zurich, so the ETH. He's trained in France, in what I read, in Paris and Nice. And he was for quite a while a professor at the geophysics at UCLA in Los Angeles, and where I was visiting also frequently David Neelan. And so I remember quite some lively discussions on earthquake prediction at that time, particularly there, of course, in the area of Los Angeles. He then went on to at ETH, and he's now also founding member of the Risk Center at ETH Zurich. He published a number of books, and one of the books I highly recommend is here, The Critical Phenomena in Natural Sciences. It's a very nice overview of also the methodology, but also of the phenomena. And so if you don't know it yet, highly recommend it. With that, I'll give the floor to Didier, and we're looking forward to your lecture.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this nice introduction. It's a pleasure to be with you. Unfortunately, I cannot see your intelligent and motivating faces, but I will try to nevertheless speak to my screen as if, you know, I imagine all of you. So I would like to share with you research, which is of course very much shared and collaborative with the list of co-authors that you see, and probably I forget others. Sham Nadan was my PhD and a postdoc, now senior researcher in geophysics and earthquake prediction. Giu Yu has been with me forever since 1993 or 4, also on earthquake modeling. Michael Schatz also was a PhD of mine, mathematicians. Alexander Verli, also a mathematician, working part-time at Swiss National Bank and recently finished his PhD. Spencer Whitley, also previous master and PhD student, postdoc, working at UBS now. And we have tried together to push forward the question of the endo-exo problem, as I call it. So it has a vast domain of application. And but before diving into it, I want to just tell you what I'm not going to speak about, because in the title and in the abstract, I mentioned these several papers. So I'm not going to speak about them because I realized, well, I was preparing the talk that would be too much. But let me nevertheless advertise a collaboration with a Japanese statistical physicist, theoretical physicist, Kiyoshi Kanazawa in Tokyo, with whom we think we had done some breakthrough by being able to solve analytically linear and nonlinear self-excited Hox process, or large class of processes that I will tell you about a bit later. Which is essentially a class of self-excited epinning process that has been used and are actually the best benchmark for earthquake statistical descriptions and prediction, but also in the last 10, 15 years has been hugely utilized for in finance, from small scale, ultra high frequency to large scale, for example, modeling of default from SAD. Default swap, for example, instruments. So we have found the way to solve this problem, which is not trivial because it's non-Markovian, with very long memory, and we have been able to actually, through the use of auxiliary field variables, to map this onto partial differential equations, which are solvable, at least asymptotically, and we have unearthed a number of Paolo, for example, the Paolo distribution of the rates of activity. And in the last paper, which is currently submitted, we have found a new mechanism for Zipf's law that emerged when we generalize this self-excited conditional Poisson process or Hox-Pon process with nonlinear behavior, like exponential, for example, and we have a generic. So I will not speak about this, but just for you, if some of you are interested, you can contact me, I can send you papers or presentation, and I can elaborate some discussion if you are interested. What I'm going to speak about is the endo-exo problem, and to pose the discussion on a broad base. For example, we can look at climate viability. Okay, we are all interested in climate viability these days with the discussion of human earth sustainability, climate change, and so on. And of course, when you look at the spectrum, You see here the variance as a function of the period in years. You see peaks or broad blobs everywhere at all timescales, right? And the big question, of course, is what are these cycles coming from? Are they due to these nonlinear endogenous feedback processes, or could they be due to external forcing that, or a mixture of them, of course, because the system is highly nonlinear? So this is one of the questions. Another application, of course, is finance, where you have timescales going from millisecond or sub-millisecond to years, decades, and so on, and you have so many phenomena and type of strategies, investment processes, and so on, from and structure and design, like stop loss, like circuit breaker, like also condition, like margin calls, execution issues, and so on, that give rise to this fantastic, rich data structure, which of course have attracted many of us who are interested in complex systems. It's one of the most complex systems. In a way, actually, in financial economics, we speak about the efficient market hypothesis, which essentially means, in my understanding or my way of understanding it, is that the market is a super intelligent entity in the sense that it is made of all the intelligence of all of us who are trying to make money. And it is the integration of all this intelligence that this has led to essentially very difficult opportunities for arbitrage. So this question is how to understand what is external and what is internal to the dynamics of these complex systems. And my personal investigation or love affair with this endo-exo world actually started at the beginning of 2003, almost 20 years ago or 18 years ago, when my book, other book, Why Stock Market Crash, which actually has been more successful than the one that was recommended in the introduction, for obvious reason given the title, was commented on by following an interview I gave in December on this Money Central website, at which time I was made aware of by my student who were following the sales on Amazon, that coming from, let's say, a rank of 50,000, which is typical for a rather good book from an academics, which contains quite a number of equations, my book jumps to rank 5 on Amazon.com, together with, you know, Harry Potter's books on cooking recipes and this kind of thing, right? And you had one book, you know, in science, making it at number 5. And so, as a scientist, being, you know, full of curiosity, I asked myself, what happened? What happened? And so it started this journey. And I realized that actually we can understand this, and we aggregated a lot of data and so on. So it's a long story that I will not go through. But we understood that indeed in the dynamic of sales of books, you have the caricature of these two. These are real data of the two extreme processes where you have, for example, a book that sells typically 5-10 books a day, right? That's on Amazon. And then something happens, like, for example, in this book, Strong Women Stay Young, The New York Times on the Sunday, June 4, published an article crediting, you know, the author of groundbreaking research and the book that you have to buy if you woman who goes through a menopause wants to stay young. Now you can imagine on Monday morning, hordes of women in their 40s and 50s buying the book and so on. And you see here on Amazon, the peak where 1,000 books were sold every day. And then it decays with a characteristic Paolo decay, actually. This is an exogenous shock typical of a system that is shocked by something. And then you see what we call in physics a relaxation function, response function, right? That was what happened for my book. My book was subjected to an exogenous shock. And then we had this strong peak of activity of buys and then relaxation. And endogenous shock is when, through word of mouth, click of mouse, social processes, imitation, networking, and so on, the dynamics, the variable of sales grows progressively and decays. And our studies have shown that, of course, it's much better to be endogenous than exogenous, but of course, you cannot, it's very difficult to engineer endogeneity. It's essentially capture the quality of the book, or rather, maybe the adequacy, the resonance that the book has with the social network. And I would like just to remind you, because I understand that there's a broad audience of many different disciplines, maybe attending this talk, that there is a fundamental in general relationship between the endo fluctuation and the exogenous response. So of course, in this system, this kind of systems is much more out of equilibrium, more complicated, but there is a field where the relationship between endo and exo has been well understood. And this is known as response theory and also known under the term the fluctuation dissipation theorem or the fluctuation susceptibility theorem. And essentially what is said is that if you shock a system and you measure the response function, then the response function informs you on the internal spontaneous fluctuation and variability of the system. Essentially at equilibrium for this class of system under some conditions, you show that the Fourier transform of the response function is equal to the, or rather the Fourier transform of the coefficient function, well, okay, the same, gives you the response function. So there's a deep relationship between how a system responds to an external shock and its internal state and its fluctuation, which is quite intuitive and reasonable. So actually, as you know, the forefather or godfather of this was Einstein in 1905, who actually developed this remarkable first early endo-exo relationship through this equation, relating, I could call, the endo characteristic of spontaneous fluctuating Brownian particle embedded in a fluid characterized by the diffusion coefficient, where R2 is the radius of gyration after time t, and d is the dimension of space, to what I could call the exogenous response of the system characterized by the viscous coefficient. And this is a famous Einstein relation that shows probably one of the first endo-exo relationship in this type of system. Now, hordes of physicists, in particular mathematicians, have tried to understand under what condition this relationship, this deep relationship. If you think about it, it's super interesting, right? To think that you measure system endogenously, fluctuations, behavior, and so on, and you can predict how it would respond to unknown shocks or vice versa. And this is, of course, used by experimentalists, by all scientists who want to study in biology, between biology and urban sciences, in physics, in chemistry, everywhere, right? Now, what happens is the system is much more complicated, is out of equilibrium, and exhibit bifurcation. And there are generalizations of this fluctuation susceptibility theorem, but of course there are issues and there are deviations. For example, the question is, what if perturbations are not living within the attractors of the system? That could be possible out of equilibrium. And what happens if, for example, the attractor of the dynamic exhibit bifurcation? So there are very rich possibility of applications that is opening in this field of endo-exo generalization. So this hint for the endo-exo and the feedback between the two is pervading all sciences. Here I mentioned seismology, and I will come back to this, economics, time series fluctuation, epidemiology, physics, finance, and of course, biology and environmental sciences. Exogeneity refers to, for example, the fact that there are deterministic trends, there's inhomogeneity, trend change at the point of time due to external forcing, there's diversity, heterogeneity, et cetera, et cetera. While endogeneity more refers to stochastic fluctuation, clustering, coupling, contagion, reflexivity, et cetera, the triggering process, epidemic process, and so on. So I would like first to anchor my discussion, and I will try to present to you some what I consider very interesting results obtained in our team on how we can distinguish, a key question, how to distinguish endo and exo. And this has deep consequences because it allows us, for example, to, in the case of finance, it will be the question of how much do the prices fluctuate due to internal, you know, for example, investment trading interaction between investors, as opposed to fluctuating as a response to external shocks, which would be, let's say, news or publication of new economic data that are surprises and that lead the investor to reassess their portfolios according to the new information that is coming. And the question it would be is how much, you know, and if we find, and I will show you that maybe 70-80% of the trade, 70-80% of the mid price changes in the stock market are due to endogenous process, and only about 30% are due to external news. So there is a large domain of endogeneity, but not 100%. So the market is not critical, and I will discuss that. And I will ask the same question for earthquakes, and we can go on and on, but I will only focus on these two domains. And earthquake, the big question is, we know that earthquake trigger other earthquakes, and until recently, my best knowledge from many investigations was that maybe 99% or 99.9% or even more of earthquakes were due to past earthquakes. And I will show you recent results with very sophisticated and elaborate technique that have allowed us to make a great start in this domain. So actually, all these questions are also have also deep roots in time series and spatial time series analysis in statistics. And I would like to stress for you who may not be statistician and statistical experts that there are many misconceptions. So let me go quickly through them. So for example, the very big one is mistaking deterministic trends, which can maybe shift and with the turning point and so on, with irregularity, as due to stochastic memory process. I will comment on that a bit more even. For example, there may be systemic errors in measurement and so on, or slow drift in underlying parameters, regime shift, et cetera, that gives the impression of long and strong endogenous memory, right? The second misconception that we'll attack front-wise is, in general, it's impossible to distinguish between endogeneity and exogeneity, to separate the internal dynamics from what is due to external shocks, right? And actually, we have participated recently with my senior researcher and postdoc and a PhD student with a number of conferences with the top-notch statisticians. And this is, and we were surprised to learn that in their words, this is still a fundamental open problem. They think that in general, it's impossible to solve. I'm going to show that within the class of the self-excited conditional point processes, it's possible to have extremely accurate classification of the endo part and exo part. And we can, of course, demonstrate that by doing very elaborate simulations, you know, experiment of the computer to show that indeed knowing what we generate in terms of endo-exo, we can recuperate it and then we can apply it to real data and get very interesting conclusions. So these questions of endo-exo and the fact that there are systemic errors and there are drift and so on is of course the very long history, right? A eminent scientist and statistician, you have the name here, Newcomb, Pearson, student and so on, have mentioned these problems, but it seemed it has been mainly forgotten or ignored by mainstream, right? For example, the famous student analysis of Guinness Beer Company by, you know, the Mr. Gosse, who used a student to publish his work. And of course, he was the inventor of the student t-distribution and of the t-test and so on, showed that indeed so-called IID observation done with great care are highly correlated. And you should take that into account. So that flexible trend could remove these flexible systematic errors. An example that you probably know of is this Hurst phenomenon, right? When Hurst was studying the Lavon, the capacity of this S1 dam on the Nile, right? And showed, and you see the spectrum here, and you see the variability of the nilometer, right? Which suggests to the eye very, you know, strong, long memory and so on. You see the spectrum, which is a power and so on, which gives a Hurst exponent 0.85. The top probabilist failure, all of us know failure, you know, for the great book that he has written, he disagreed. And he said that actually I can account for all these data with short memory IID models when accounting for exogenous trends and regime shifts. Of course. But of course, the story developed differently with Mandelbrot introduced the fractional brain motion and then justifying essentially this long memory padding that has become so much fashionable. But with the danger that we tend to take it so much for granted that we forget actually that it is important also to account for complexity in the exogeneity as I'm going to show with specific example. So detrending is a game of messaging data that all of us are doing. It's extremely dangerous to do it, and you need to actually to both develop models and models of errors and fluctuations jointly in order to know how to detrend. If you don't detrend, you're going to get spurious phenomena because of the trend being taken up as meaning long-range memory. But if you don't take into account of the trend and the positive regime shift, your conclusion would be also ill-founded or spurious, right? So these are standard approaches. And I want to just finish this short review by mentioning that of course the endo-exo in economics and in econometrics is prominent, and eminent statisticians and econometricians have commented on the fact that to use only linear trends or exponential trends, which is a general current practice, is far too constrained. And Harvey, also a famous guy, trends cannot be adequately captured by straight lines, right? And no one understands trends, okay? So there are all these issues of how to deal with these short and long memories and the regime shifts, which is this exo aspect entangled in the endo. So this is the motivation for us to look at this Hawkes point process and to try to solve the problem. I will show you that we have found a solution for this. So what are these models? These models can be represented by and can be mapped mathematically exactly on branching processes where you have immigrants, exogenous sources, could be earthquakes due to plate tectonics. It could be news that trigger a trade in finance. And then this trade or this earthquake trigger other earthquakes or the trades, and then the system dies off, and then you have new immigrants, new background event that start process. And what you see is, of course, the superposition of this effect, right? And so the exogeneity will be these immigrants, and the endogeneity will be the children, the daughters created by the immigrants, right? So in this case, the model has a very straightforward interpretation in terms of what is endo and what is exo. Specifically, I'm interested to start with a simple version of the model. So a point process describe, it's a counting process, which counts how many events has occurred. It could be, as I said, mid-price change, number of trades, could be number of earthquakes, could be the cumulative number of epileptic seizures in the brain up to a point, could be whatever number of sales of books, number of hits that you have on your web page and so on. So you count the process of this points on the timeline, right? And you unfold this to have this picture of exogenous immigrants, right, that come here. Some of them have no children, some, you know, trigger large avalanches and so on. The way to model this point process is to write what is called the intensity, which is the lambda t dt, is the probability in the interval between t and t plus dt that an event will occur. Right, and you decompose it into, and this is a simple linear decomposition, into what is called a background intensity mu and the self-excitation part, which is the sum of over all past events that occurred at previous time, T1, T2, Ti, which is carrying the information triggering future event with a memory function, which is phi. And in a mean field version, you characterize the strength of this inference for the future through what is called the branching ratio, which has essentially two definitions or two meanings. The first one is the average number of daughters of first generation per mother. So for example, here in this diagram, you see that this mother gave two daughters. This one gave two, this one gives one, this one gives zero. So you average over all these numbers of first generation daughter and you get this branching ratio. Right. And of course, you know that there is a critical phase transition. It's called a branching phase transition where n equals one is a critical value, n less than one subcritical, the system dies off or is stationary under a non-zero immigrant field. And of course, when n is larger than one, you have with some probability larger than one, that larger than zero, the probability to explode exponentially. Okay, the second meaning of n, it's very easy to show exactly that it is a fraction of triggered events. So for example, here I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 exogenous events, and all the rest are triggered, right? So n is the number of the events which have been triggered over the total number of events. In this simulation, it's, for example, 0.88, right? 0.88 also means that on average, each immigrant or each element, not just immigrants, but also each event triggered on average 0.88 events following it, right? So another last thing I need to say that is very easy to show that if you have a background mu, which is the exogenous component that you don't see, what you are going to see, the activity, right? The total number of earthquake, the total rate of earthquake will be renormalized to the value mu over 1 minus n, because essentially mu is the first rate of background per unit time. Each of this background event will create n event on average. Each of this n event will create n events on average. And so if you iterate, you get mu plus mu times n plus mu times n squared plus mu times n cubed and so on. You sum and you get mu over 1 minus n. So for example, if you take n equals 0.9, it means what you observe is an activity which is 10 times that of the exogenous driving force, right? So you can have a very, very strong fluctuation. And of course, the variance is larger and so on and so forth. When we started to be interested in this problem with my book in 2003, we looked at a lot of data, books on Amazon and also videos on YouTube and so on. And we identify actually the fact that this memory function is generically for media, social systems, book sales, video, success, etc., is a parallel. A parallel, which is a character by an exponent close to 1.5. Theta is close to 0.5. We found that it's about 0.3, 0.4. You can actually relate it to this exponent 1.5 for the response time in the correspondence of Einstein and Darwin. It is the same parallel we can show exactly. But the point is that as you have this renormalization that just gave you a flavor of, you can have also a renormalization in the fact that, for example, if you have an exogenous event here, of course, there will be a time distribution of the first generation, a time distribution of these guys triggering the grandmother of the initial mother, the grand-grandmother, and so on. And you have a renormalized decay. We can call it a dressed propagator, while phi is the bare propagator, if you like, the bare memory function. And you can show that depending on whether you have a shock and the system is critical when n goes to 1, this response function will be renormalized with a smaller exponent, 1 minus theta. And if you have an endocritical response, which is like a bit this case I was showing you before with this endogenous book here, then the exponent will be 1 minus 2 theta. So you have a dynamical signature of both the criticality and of the nature of the shock, whether it is endo or exo. And we have actually shown that this is remarkably verifiable on data, for example, on videos on YouTube. So, and we have all type of behavior. For example, the Book of Oprah, Personal Trainer, is such a bad book so that it decays super fast, has this exo peak when he's promoted on the show of Oprah, right? You know, but then she has to revaccine, and so on in order to try to push Personal Trainer success. On the other hand, you have this endo success, for example, of activity of developers. Another application is for open source software developers that is, again, described by the same universal exponent, about 0.3. I don't understand, by the way, the origin of 0.3. Classical mean field theory for priority queuing theory will predict theta equals 0.5. I don't understand the difference between 0.5 and 0.3 that we observe empirically. Now, so this is what I want to get close to. So we have these dynamics of earthquakes or dynamic of financial volatility. They look very similar, right? And the idea is that indeed, when you see that, this is a very good playground to apply these classes of model of self-excitation. And this has been done by many, and you see the citation by Bakri and R showing in particular the vast application of this class of model for finance. Right. So now, when we started to, my group actually in earthquake in 1999, we were one of the first to apply this to try to develop the theory for earthquakes. For the statistical aspect, it was developed earlier by Ogata, a mathematical statistician in Japan. And we were, I think, the first to actually write this paper in 2012, which is the first quantification of reflexivity in financial markets using this model. Because as I told you, if you can calibrate the model on the data, you're going to obtain this branching ratio, and the branching ratio will give you immediately what is the fraction of the trades or of the mid-price change that are due to endogeneity, due to previous events, due to previous trades, for example. And our work showed unambiguously, using time window of 10 to 20 minutes or 30 minutes, that over the years, the branching ratio has grown, but has that more lately plateaued around 0.7, 0.75. After our paper was published, and actually I sent it to Soros. Soros was, George Soros, the father of the concept of reflexivity in his book and so on, the very successful quant hedge fund manager, known for the £1 or 2 billion that he made on the back of the Central Bank of the UK. So was very happy to see our work being the first one quantifying his qualitative concept. But then Bouchot and his group fought back. So Bouchot is an old friend of mine. We have a long history together. Sometimes we fight, sometimes we collaborate. He came back a year later with a paper saying, no. And he actually contacted me saying, Didier, how is it possible? You are a statistical physicist. How can you believe that the stock market is not critical? And he used the same model as ours, but a slightly different methodology and much larger time window, like up to 3 months. And he found that the branching ratio is essentially stable at one. And of course, this finding is of great pleasure for a physicist, right? And a complex system scientist, because it means that somehow this complex system has stabilized, has self-organized critical, to this specific point, which is a priori and stable. There is magical mechanism that attract the system there. And of course, not so magical because we understand some of them. And so we started a gentleman discussion and fight, if you like, to see what is going on, right? And so this is what we obtained. So what we did, we developed the model to account for exogenous background, but time varying, very important, because there's lunch effect, there's the opening effect, the close effect, and so on, and humans are subjected to circadian cycle and so on. We also introduce sophistication with exoshock, which can be also dynamic-dependent, and then we have this endodynamic. So it's a slight generalization of the Hoch process, accounting for a bit more viability. And it's very important that to take into account, for example, the fact that structural break like lunch should not be misinterpreted spuriously as a clustering effect due to endogeneity, but actually is really an exogenous effect of, trading stops due to humans activity. And I want to attract your attention to the fact that, for example, when you generate a Hoch process, and here you see the intensity realization, and then you smooth it, right, with a blue curve, and then you use the smooth curve as the mu of t, the background, as pure exogenous, and you put n equals zero, zero endogeneity, zero branching ratio, you are unable to distinguish the two processes in terms of their realization, for example, as quantified by the autocorrelation function. You see the two curves correspond to one, the true model that has been generated close to criticality with a significant endo component, and the other curve corresponds to the pure exo, but with a time-varying, inhomogeneous, time-dependent process of the background, okay? So this is a question, right? This is a question. So this is, of course, analogous to the unit root debate in time series, which continues to flow, for decades and decades, where you have the unit rooters who think that everything is critical or close to unit root, and it's unit root for physicists means that the system is essentially undergoing a Brownian motion, while if the parameter is less than one, it means that it's, in the language of physicists, is a Hornstein-Hüllenbeck process, and the system is stationary, right? And you have the other school of deterministic trainers, and there's a fight between the two. And there's still ongoing discussion, as I was showing. In our case, what we showed, for example, here you see simulations showing an intensity which is created by a model with a significant endogeneity. There's also this shock process, which is the exo component, and the mu, the light, the gray here at the bottom, is the time varying realization of the exo part. So you have two exo part, right? The two daggers part, the background and the shocks, right? And what you see in terms of realization is the light gray, right? What we were able to show that by our approach, we can recover the decomposition almost perfectly. For example, the red curve is our reconstruction just on the basis of the measurement of the time series of the events of the sum of the background exo and the exo shocks. And you see it captures very well, nicely, the sum of the two, allowing to distinguish and disentangle all the exo from the endo, and we recover the branching ratio very nicely. How do we do it? The technology is a bit intricate. It's the so-called expectation maximization algorithm, which essentially amounts to an iterative process to guess through expectation and then likelihood formulation maximization likelihood what are hidden variables, and the hidden variables or hidden quantities are the genealogy of the process. So, you know, previously I was showing you the tree of a mother coming in, giving daughters, granddaughters, and so on. Of course, the specific genealogy is not known. We can actually construct a matrix telling us what is the genealogy and invert it through this expectation maximization algorithm. The originality, so it's a relatively recent achievement. It was not us who developed this expectation maximization. Our contribution has been to implement it with time-varying mu, time-varying lambda, theta, meaning exo contribution, and also using information criteria, AIC or BIC, Bayesian information criteria, in order to penalize the number of degrees of freedom. And we use log spline in order to parameterize the flexibility of this exogenous component. Right, and what we show, so I will be quick and just to give you the flavor, we show that revisiting criticality and also enlarging the windows to days, we can exclude completely, you know, you see the big information criterion compared to the best one, that for, as a function of branching ratio, there's no way you can explain a branching ratio equal to one. So we completely punch Bouchot down to the ground and show that indeed the system is as a significant endogenous component, but is very far from criticality. And if we for example, force the branching ratio to be close to one, we can recover by this methodology the memory kernel, and it is long tail, fat tail with a parallel tail. But if we actually let the branching ratio to self-adjust as we should, then we see that a sign of a relatively long tail of the memory process, but then a taper. So what is interesting is that criticality and long memory come together. If you impose them, you are going to see them together. What is spurious, actually? And spurious because you are not accounting for the flexibility of the Lunch effect of the exogenous time dynamics. And this holds also, this is the work with Alex Verli also, and when you generalize the process to bivariate or multivariate self-excited excitation, for example, you have the dynamics of mid-price change, you have the dynamics of traits, and you have a matrix of mutual excitation, trade triggers trade, mid-price change triggers mid-price change, and cross, and you have cross terms where mid-price change can trigger trade and so on. And you can generalize this. So there is a whole mathematics of this, and you obtain that indeed what you're generalizing the branching ratio is a so-called spectral radius. The spectral radius is bounded very far away from one with very high statistical confidence. And we show that actually, depending on the number of degrees of freedom, we have very good statistical significance and very strong confidence that indeed the branching ratio of the spectral radius is bounded away from one at a level of about 70%. So 70% of what we see of the moves are due to endogeneity. And this is showing you our, for example, recovery for the Euro-US data of what is the time dependence of the background, both for the number of trades and the mispriced change, showing the interrelationship between the two. So we can test also marginal process like marked ARMA, autoregressive moving average point process, which is a kind of generalized Hoax process account in the same way that Hoax process maps to a moving average, to an autoregressive process. We can also generalize the moving average and then also with this more evolved model show that again, the spectral radius is bounded away from one is of the order of 0.7. So more recently with Alex Verli, what we have done is to generalize to the Hoax PQ model, saying there's no reason for not only the background mu to be dependent on time, but the branching process, the branching ratio itself. So the branching ratio is a measure of fertility, of triggering, of propensity. There's no reason that it should be constant. That should be, you know, humans are varying all the time and so on. So what about allowing P degrees of freedom for the background and Q degrees of freedom for this branching process? And so we have analyzed a number of markets here that are shown, that show that when you allow this, you can recover the branching dynamics as a form of time, which can sometimes approaches one, especially when we dealt here in this paper with flash crashes that occur at high frequency. So they were very rich behavior. So this is first a numerical simulation to show that actually when we put something, we can recover it very nicely. And we have applied it to a number of different data. For example, this is the 10-year US Treasury notes, or this is the US dollar euro currency, and so on. And at the bottom, it is the Standard & Poor's 500 E-minis. And in this case, you see that we can recover the background structure as a function of time and the dynamics of the branching ratio, which sometimes can peak, can grow to even values of one, I think like in the previous cases, or in general remain safely bounded away from one. So it allows us to classify the origin of the flash crash, like you see a massive drop of activity, which can occur. For example, the SP 500 in May 6, 2010 is one of the most famous flash crash where over a few minutes, the market dropped by almost 10%. And the question is it exo? Is it endo? A mixture of the two? And you see here that we see a mixture of the two, a very strong endogenous component, but also an increase of endogeneity, a strong exo component, an increase of endogeneity, but it's not purely endo. Now, I see that I have essentially consumed my time. How much do you give me? 5 more minutes? Or should I stop? Because I wanted to tell you, yeah, how much?
You can continue, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, because now I want to tell you about some application of these approaches, these Hoax processes, to earthquakes. So now I see I have 5 minutes or a bit less to summarize a number of papers. So I will be fast, but give you the main message. So here for earthquake, the same structure, you know, the intensity, but now it's spatial temporal. So you have background, the background can be also time dependent, and now you have this function of production or triggering of future earthquakes by past earthquake, which now has 3 components. One is the productivity. So how many earthquake daughters do a given earthquake create, and it is a function of its magnitude. It's a parallel function of the energy. It's an exponential function of the magnitude. The second component is the so-called Omori law, which essentially quantifies what the memory of how an earthquake in the past continues to trigger in the future, according to this parallel with the Omori exponent omega. And the third component is the spatial decay law that characterizes the influence. Of course, the underlying physics is stress transfer, activation process, and so on and so forth. So the main application of this model. So I should say, as I repeat, that this model has been the workhorse of statistical seismology, and variants of this model consist best models in terms of forecasting earthquake, aftershocks, and so on. So this is really the very important class where all the experts are bound, if they propose something, they are bound to actually make a horse race to be sure that they provide something in addition. Most of the application have assumed that mu is homogeneous, is not varying as a functional space, and the story here will be exactly the same. This is a fundamental mistake, giving rise to spurious conclusions. So we have developed a number of techniques to account, for example, by Voronoi complexity methods and so on, to allow the mu, the background event, to vary as a function of space. And we have shown this through, again, complexity measures, big Bayesian information criterion measure, how it's possible to quantify the number, the complexity in space and so on through, and we found by this expectation maximization method, how to be able to recover the spatial structure of the background rate, which correlates very well with, for example, thermal anomalies in California here. And the branching ratio, you see who can be characterized by hotspots, where the branching ratio can be it can be locally larger than one, meaning critical, but overall it's not critical. So accounting for spatial variabilities is essential. Another point that we discovered is that actually there are important deviations from these two laws, which are fundamental in earthquake, Omorodion and Guidenberger law. One is the tempo activity earthquakes of triggering. The other one is the distribution of earthquake magnitude, which translates into a parallel distribution of earthquake seismic moment or zero frequency energy. But we have discovered that actually the expansion of the Omorodion law is magnitude dependent. So it's and it varies from a number which is quite larger than one to smaller than one. So this is the behavior that we have discovered in about 2005 in Physical Review Letter and reported also in Journal of Physical Research. And you see the variation of this exponent. And there are deep reasons for this, which I don't have time to develop. They are related to what we call temporal multifractality, which is embedded into the activation of rupture. You have an exponential activation like Arrhenius' law with an effective temperature and the stress field, which is itself due to all the previous earthquakes mediating the influence on a given time through the Green function of space and time, how the stress perturbation are due to previous earthquake and can influence the stress field and their trigger through thermal activation, the future earthquake. If you solve this model, you find the prediction that the p-value of the Omorodion law is a function of the magnitude of the main shock. So, and you can solve it here. So there is also another discovery that is quite remarkable more recently with Shem Naden and Guillon, which is actually a result that support a very deep theory by a mathematician, Verre Jones, that showed that the pure exact self-similar model, generalizing all process, has to have two branches in the Guidenberger distribution. And this band has to be at the magnitude of the triggering earthquake. So here, what I plot is the distribution of the magnitude of the earthquake triggered by a given earthquake of magnitude, of a reference magnitude. And what we have found is that this band does exist when you use the EM, expectation maximization method, to reconstruct the genealogy of earthquake, accounting for all these processes I told you before. And this is a very strong effect. And when we use this improved Hoch process in pseudo-prospective prediction tests, we find that the spatial varying and with these additional ingredients overperform with an information gain of up to one per earthquake compared to the existing earthquakes. So I see that my time is finishing. I will finish with two announcements. This is a paper in Physical Review Letters that is going to be published in 1 or 2 weeks, where we answer to the question, is seismicity operating at a critical point? And the answer is no, contrarily to essentially all previous studies, which we claim are spurious, because they have not adequately taken into account the spatial variability. And we show that the model of Hoch's that accounts for the spatial variability beats in terms of cumulative information gains, all existing predicting models in different geographical resolutions and different magnitude band. And you see the cumulative gain in information compared to the benchmark that exists, showing that indeed not only, of course, it gives a branching ratio that goes from critical when you don't take into account non-uniformity of the background event. You see it goes from 1 to 1.15 to 0.4, or 1 to 0.7, 8, 9, or 1.14 to 0.6. But also, and this is a validation step, it predicts much better the forecast. And the last thing is that large earthquakes are mostly triggered by large earthquakes. So we actually put all these ingredients together. I realize that I'm going very fast and must be completely behind me. But putting, you know, the Hoax process with spatial dependence, with being able to reconstruct with the expectation maximization the viability of the background event, by accounting for a magnitude dependent Mori law, and by accounting for the fact that there are two branches in the Guden-Doritzer law, we have a model 4, which contains all these ingredients, and turns out to be by far the winner in all prediction tests that we do. And this validates, and we show that as a consequence, the distribution of earthquakes, here the fraction of earthquakes of a given magnitude larger than M, triggered by event of M, is picked. So it means that earthquakes of given magnitude are preferentially triggered by magnitude of the same size. And we have looked at different variations of this quantity and we find the same thing. So I will finish here with this slide suggesting, you know, that this endo-exo problem has a vast domain of application. I told you a bit about the application to financial time series, volatility burst. I told you a bit and quite fast application of earthquake, where we are in both fields extremely excited by the implications and the operational consequences. And I did not have time to actually cover all, there are many more. We have in the past also looked at endogeneity for financial crashes and bubbles at a much larger scale with different techniques. We have some, to some degree, model also the dynamic of the immune system as an endo-exo problem. I mentioned the studies on book sales, commercial sales, ads, and so on. And here I list other domains where I do believe, I have a strong belief that this endo-exo problem, or let's say framing, can be extremely rich in order to advance our understanding. So I apologize for being a bit long. I will stop here and will be happy if you have still the energy to ask questions.
Okay, thank you very much, Didier. Very interesting, particularly the all the recent work. So let's thank Didier. I mean, you can put your reactions in the clapping or whatever. Or so let's open the discussion and. One discussion was already by, one question was sort of posed by Jaap Mont already. So Jaap, can you ask it to DJ?
Your microphone is off, Jaap.
Yes.
Yeah, right. Now you probably can hear me clearly.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, I'm a geophysicist and of course, very much interested in earthquakes. And my question actually in the chat was, I wonder whether you would be able with your theory to predict the existence and the occurrence of earthquakes, not only in terms of location, but also in time. And of course, this is very relevant in the Netherlands because we have very many small earthquakes due to the gas production in the Groningen gas field. So my first part was actually, are these earthquakes considered to be endo or exo? And secondly was then, can you apply your approach to predict the occurrence or strength of future earthquakes?
So thank you for the question, because in the 7 minutes or 10 minutes I use for covering the earthquake part, everything when I said that I described about the performance of prediction was performance of prediction in space and time. So it's not the future, we are doing it already. And indeed, when the Hoax process, the ETAS model is called epidemic type aftershock sequence model in the field of statistical seismology, of course, has a goal and is applied, and you probably have heard about the Collaboratory for Earthquake Predictability, which is a long-lived initiative worldwide and so on, where it is Zurich is quite a lot involved, but they're also in California. There's the SEC at the USC and so on and so forth. Italy is also involved, Japan, China, and so on. So New Zealand also. So there is a whole community using various models, including many variants of the ETAS model, or the Hox process, to actually predict or they don't like to say predict, they prefer to say forecast, to forecast future events. And so all these tests that you see, for example, on this slide here, or this one here, which are the mean information gain, are per earthquake, are the gain in terms of information gain, right? So defined in terms of likelihood and so on, of how much better in terms of timing and space location, but timing is a very large contribution, did we do compared to competing models? So the answer is yes, it is done. We are doing it all the time. And in our methodology and our approach models and so on, and many methodology, which is this expectation maximization, accounting also for the large complexity of the background event. I stressed that a lot during my talk today. We aim at forecasting events, and we aim at forecasting events in order to validate the sophistication of the model, because we, in my view, the best, as a physicist, I would say, the best, or as an economist also, the best support evidence, supporting evidence for a model is its capacity to predict the future, right? Forecast either the future or new phenomena, a new characteristic, new mechanism. So we use the forecasting ability continuously in order to validate the model, and then we infer new properties. For example, in this case, I did not have time to discuss, but we find that the doublet mechanism of large earthquake is a genuine phenomenon. It was not proven till now. I think now we have proven it. Now, I think there is another component of equation, which is even with the most, we claim we have mega horse race, our approach is by far the best in the world compared to everything that has been published, right? Now, is it good enough to be operationally useful? So it is, I'm smiling about this because it is actually very good for predicting aftershocks. So once a big earthquake has occurred, or relatively large earthquake has occurred, this class of models are actually implemented. And we have actually a platform called RicherX. I should have mentioned it before, and I should give you the, you just have Richter, like Richelieu, RicherX. And it is a personal platform that gives 10 minutes updates or forecasts all over the world with this class of models. So it's very, very powerful for predicting aftershock. Unfortunately, there is no model existing that predicts sufficiently accurately the surprise background events. So there are still events of large magnitude that are surprise. Once they occur, they trigger their cohort of aftershocks. And that's where our models and the models that exist are very efficient. And we need to account for spatial heterogeneity and all that. So voilà, this is the state of the art. And I should add that my hope, and we are very active in this, in particular with colleagues in China, is that we could go to better predictability by enriching these models with many other variables that are not purely seismicity or past seismicity triggering future seismicity. But for example, looking at if we could have access to that, but it's very difficult stress patterns, but you can have other variables like various anomalies, for example, magnetic anomalies, electric anomalies, ionosphere anomalies, infrared anomalies, and so on. Many anomalies, as you know, have been reported over the decades and centuries. There are difficulties understanding where they can come from and how they are related to earthquakes. There is, in my view, sufficient evidence that the hypothesis that they can be useful is worthwhile to investigate. And that's what we are doing, to enrich through a multi-phenomena, a multi-variable process, this class of models.
Yeah, what if I may, one other question would be that in the north, where we have this giant gas field, we have continuous monitoring of microseismicity. Now, would it be possible to use that microseismicity and sort of instantaneous sort of start predicting the timing, maybe a magnitude of coming future earthquakes?
Yes. So essentially what you are saying, that this is a field of induced earthquakes. It's called induced yes. seismicity. Yes. And of course, we have worked a lot on this. And indeed, this class of models are very good for that. It is used already. Some companies are doing it. And yes, it's feasible. This is easier, actually, than the big problem of predicting earthquakes, you know, when they are naturally made, because here you know the source. So you know the source because there have been studies correlating the background event to the forcing, right? The forcing, which is the rate of extraction, the pressure at the front of time of water of the brine that is pushing the, in, for example, for oil recovery and all this stuff. So yes, there is a very promising research and even operational implementation using this type of techniques.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yeah, thanks. Any other question? Well, while you're thinking, I'll ask another question. I mean, is it always, I can imagine for financial, say, problems you mentioned in earthquakes, that it's easy to distinguish exo and endo. But you started with climate variability, and I would say then it's less easy to distinguish endo and exo. It would depend on the time scale. For instance, I mean, if you have a varying carbon dioxide concentration, if you look at it in present day, you would consider it as exo, right? But if you look at it within the carbon cycle of the whole Earth system, I mean, I would say you include it in endo. So how do you, is that always sort of easy to distinguish for general applications?
Yeah, very good question. Thank you. Of course, what you mentioned is that the, let's say, classification or the difference between exo and endo, which is made by construction in this Hoke's self-excited conditional point process, yeah, might be artificial, right? Might be artificial. Because you could say, let me take a very simple illustrative example. Let's say a meteorite falls on the planet and it creates extinction, right? So you could say, oh, clear, it's an exo event, as opposed, for example, to, you know, the field of self-organized criticality. I've been involved for many years in the past, where it was proposed that the waves of extinctions could be due to network effects, right? To cascades, to avalanches effects through species and genera and so on, right? A pure endo phenomenon. So in this case, you could say, oh, the meteorite is purely exo. But what if I endogenize, right, the Earth within the solar system, and so on? Then you could say, but then it becomes endo because the flow of meteorites is part of the system. And of course, all the planetary dynamics, the tides and all this stuff are influencing everything and so on. So I agree that, you know, you can always qualify something being exo as endo. In the same way in finance or in economics, when I say there are news or numbers that are published, announced every quarter and so on, right, by government or by companies and reports, and there are exo shocks impacting the investors who reassess and change their investment process. You could also argue, if you take a bigger view, right, you endogenize the economy, coupling it at a longer time scale with the stock market, taking into account the feedback loops of the financial market on the economy, because of course, finance is much bigger than the economy. It's $900 or more trillion dollar of nominal value of all the derivatives and so on, compared to the global GDP of maybe 80, 90 trillion, and the total asset value of everything on the planet, maybe about 250. Trillion, right? So the feedback loop of finance has to be endogenized. And so in that sense, my distinction between endo and exo is also maybe spurious, right? Or artificial. So, and of course, you are right also for the climate and old scales. So you could say that what I've just said has destroyed my hour or 50 minutes long talk, right? I've just destroyed myself completely, right? So how do I defend the endo-exo approach? As we know, this is my philosophy and my approach and how I practice science. You may agree or not, but I will share it nevertheless. So I think we need to, in order to progress in knowledge, we need to divide to conquer, right? So we isolate pieces and we try to distinguish what is inside and which outside. And it is in thermodynamics, we have a well-defined system and the outside. Same thing here. Actually, the outside is coupled. There is always coupled intrinsically with the system and so on. But nevertheless, this approach has been extremely useful to develop this beautifully successful thermodynamics, statistical physics, and so on which, of course, we can expand and go to out of equilibrium and to much more complex situation where the reservoir and the coupling with the internal system is much more fuzzy and no more applicable. Nevertheless, you use these techniques still to tell something intelligent to the system. And also practically or operationally to predict and to understand what is going on. Dividing to conquer is dividing the system in pieces, but also dividing timescales. Depending on the question you're asking, depending on the nature of the problem you're asking, the endo-exo, I tried to argue and to show you example, can be extremely fruitful. So in the end, I think, it's a matter of philosophy, if you want to take, an armchair position and so on. But I would claim it's a matter of operational success. I claim that by using this endo-exo, you can be extremely successful in managing your risk in finance, in understanding the stock and flow dynamics of economies, and in understanding better earthquakes, in understanding the trigger, the induced seismicity, and so on to help avoid catastrophes and so on. So, we can go on and on, but okay, voilà, that's what I want to say.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah. Okay, any other? I see Jaap has another question, but if there's anybody else, no, then Jaap?
Yeah, then what I like to know is that I've always understood that it's very dangerous to do predictions because there are many sort of consequences, legal liability, and sort of I sue you. Is that keeping you from doing predictions, or haven't you encountered that problem?
So thank you for the question. I think I am the only academic in the world making prediction, or one of the very few academic in the world making prediction. All the colleagues are freaking out or are not courageous enough or are more mindful, whatever the point of view you take. No, it has not. Actually, for many years since I am at ETH Zurich, I have worked with my group, with a number of different generation of PhDs and postdoc and senior researchers, with the vision that in order to make financial economics a real science, we need to make real predictions in real time. Otherwise, the field remains what it is. Conferences are boring. They speak of sex of angels. They are not applicable, and so on. So you want to be, to make a difference, to make something which is falsifiable. You want to make tests, testable theories, testable models, and so on. And not after the fact, not ex post, when you have schools that fight to the death for nothing, for very little consequences. So indeed, your question is well received in the sense that it's such a sensitive point, because I'm convinced that it is important to do it. And we have established over the years many types of experiment. We call it the bubble financial experiment, where for a year and a half, 2 years, around 2009, 10, and 11, we identified bubbles in tens, dozens of assets, then wrote a detailed report, published a one or two page paper with a public key, not releasing the report, and 6 months later, releasing the report, given the fact that our prediction was focused on let's say bubble that will burst in the following 6 months, precisely with a view of addressing the concern that you raised, which is You know, if we are right, people would say, oh, but you are in front of the market and the bubble crash because you said it. Or if they don't come, people would say, oh, but you did not, you in front of the market otherwise, and people took measures to avoid the crash or whatever, right? So we developed this very innovative method, you know, using the best encryptology and so on, in order to have these reports that were, so that was for which the public key was published in advance. And people then could get access to the report written in advance, 6 months later, so that we would avoid any market impact. So we played this game for 2 years and we succeeded, and you can access to these reports. They are all on the archive. I never published a paper or book on this, but they are all on the Cornell archive. We have 3 of them and you can go them, and we have several sequences of them and so on. And then we went through another type of experiment. I call it the bubble trading experiment, where I put 100,000 Swiss francs on an interactive broker account to implement concretely this. And for 3 months, we implemented it with very good success. But then my collaborators, my senior researchers said, okay, let's stop because we are becoming a hedge fund and this is not what we are paid for and that's what we want to do. So we did not publish it because it was too sensitive. You know, in financial academics and economic academics, you only publish well-dressed trivia and something that doesn't work. You don't publish things that work, right? So there's a very strong bias in the field of economics and finance, because if something works, you will not publish because it will be imitated and you know, arbitrage away. So we have, and in parallel, you can go to my Financial Crisis Observatory website, where every month we publish a report to serve the community, where we alert the community of, you know, academics, professionals, bankers, and so on, central banks, about the possible dangers and instabilities that could develop in various asset classes. So yes, we have been involved in this for now many years.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, any other question? I don't see any hand. I don't see anything in the chat. No. Well, then let me conclude by thanking Didier again for his very interesting talk and for being with us this afternoon. And the next lecture is scheduled on April 7 and will be on consciousness. So that's a totally different subject, but also very interesting, by Jacobus Sit. And you'll get the announcement again through the normal channels. So thank you everybody for attending, and particularly DJ again for giving the talk, and hope to see you all again soon. I hope the center will open, you know, in September again. That's sort of the plan. And then we'll hope to see you in on site again. Let's see if that is going to work. Bye-bye.
Okay. Thank you. Bye-bye. Okay. Bye-bye.